Is this the dagger?
G'day guys, JB here, coming at you with another episode of Legends Profile. Of course, so far we've gone through three of the better players that really get a mention in NBA history. Of course, we started with Dennis Johnson, we moved on to Kevin McHale, and of course, we went on to Dennis Rodman last week. This week, episode four, I'm going to take a look at Big Ben, Ben Wallace. Wallace, one of the most intimidating presences in the modern NBA game, one of the best defensive centers of all time, in fact one of the best defenders of all time, and certainly one of the hardest workers of all time. As we look set to get into his story, you'll see just how hard he had to work to get to the position he got in the NBA. One of the better players that doesn't get a mention throughout his era, and honestly he's a prime example of a player who dominated on the defensive end, and yet people give him little to no credit, despite the fact that everyone sits here and values highly just the defensive side of the ball. I mean, if you're going to value the defensive side of the ball, then you have to value the contributions of Big Ben Wallace. So let's get into it. Let's get into episode four of Legends Profile, and let's take a look at Ben Wallace. As always, to start with on Legends Profile, let's look over the resume and statistics of the man known as Big Ben. He's a one-time NBA champion, a three-time All-NBA second-team selection, a two-time All-NBA third-team selection, a four-time Defensive Player of the Year winner, a five-time All-Defensive first-team selection, a one-time All-Defensive second-team selection, a four-time All-Star selection, a two-time rebounding champion, and a one-time blocks champion. He finished top 10 in MVP voting three times during his career. In the regular season, he played 1,088 games, averaging 29.5 minutes per game. He averaged 5.7 points per game, 9.6 rebounds per game, 1.3 assists per game, 1.3 steals per game, and 2 blocks per game. He only turned the ball over at least once a game. He shot 47.4% from the field, 13.7% from deep, and 47.5% from the free throw line. In the playoffs, he played 130 games, averaging 34.8 minutes per game. He averaged 7.2 points per game, 11.2 rebounds per game, 1.3 assists per game, 1.5 steals per game, and 1.9 blocks per game on, again, only one turnover a game. He shot 48.2% from the field. He did not make a three-point shot in his NBA playoff career, and he shot 41.8% from the free throw line. In the NBA Finals, he played 12 games, averaging 40.4 minutes per game. He averaged 10.8 points per game, 11.7 rebounds per game, 1.2 assists per game, 1.8 steals per game, 2.2 blocks per game on just 1.1 turnovers per game. He shot 52.9% from the field. He did not make a three-point shot in the NBA Finals, and he shot 34.5% from the free throw line. Despite being undrafted, thanks to the deepest draft in NBA history, and despite his role in the most famous brawl in NBA history, Ben Wallace carved out the greatest undersized defensive center career in league history. Standing 6'9", Big Ben terrorized the league in the 2000s as its preeminent defensive middleman, anchoring one of the last great defensive champions of all time before the league decided it was time to free things up and increase the aesthetics of the game. Wallace was a throwback player mixed in the new era that saw the league go through a transition period. His gritty defensive-minded game based around hustle and effort saw him fill the shoes of Dennis Rodman, but his aesthetic look of his afro, headband, and baggy uniform saw him as the epitome of his era and indeed his team's. In turn, he remains the last player to ever be the best player on a championship team, despite a lack of offensive game. Wallace owns the title as the greatest undrafted player of all time. In hindsight, when you consider the way his career played out, he should have been taken fourth overall. But the 1996 draft class is arguably the deepest draft top to bottom in league history. Not including Wallace, the draft combines for 10 individual All-Stars, 7 All-NBA players, 4 Hall of Famers, 3 MVP winners, and a Defensive Player of the Year winner. Coming out of college, Wallace had played on the Division II level, and his size and defensive first game was not going to cut it against the likes of Shaquille O'Neal, David Robinson, Hakeem Olajuwon, Patrick Ewing, and Alonzo Mourning. But what Wallace was able to show as his career progressed was something that no school athletic program or coach could produce: energy and effort. His career start in Washington was not eye-catching. Averaging less than 6 minutes a game in just 34 games, Wallace struggled to crack into a team from an undrafted position that contained both Chris Webber and Juwan Howard. 1997-98 saw his minutes increase along with his production, and by the time the lockout season of 1999 was completed, Big Ben was receiving his fair share of court time following the departure of Webber for Mitch Richmond. This was the start of Wallace breaking out as a key defender around the league. Averaging just under 27 minutes a game and starting in 16 games, Wallace was now averaging at least one steal and two blocks a game, something he continued to do in eight of the next nine seasons. His value and position on the team had never been higher. That was when the move was made to trade him for a one-off season in Orlando. The move for Wallace to Orlando was part of a much bigger plan by the Magic. The 2000 free agent market loomed as a jackpot opportunity for the team to acquire Tim Duncan, Grant Hill, and Tracy McGrady. While it looked to be a plan that was going to work perfectly, things took a turn when Tim Duncan stayed in San Antonio and Grant Hill began to slow down with injuries that permanently affected his career. This meant that while trade pieces kept value, the Magic lost out in the long term. Ben Wallace is a perfect example of this. His single season in Orlando saw him become a permanent starter and in limited minutes display the future of his game. In the 2000 offseason, Wallace was traded to Detroit along with Chucky Atkins for Grant Hill, the man that had given the Pistons a pulse during the 1990s. This saw Wallace get paid. In his career to date, Big Ben had earned just over $2.2 million. His first year alone with his new team saw him amass $4 million, and he proved to be worth every single penny. Ben was the first piece of their eventual championship puzzle, and was the only member of his opening night squad in his Pistons debut that would be holding the Larry O'Brien trophy some 3 years, 9 months later. While Detroit suffered a 10-game slump from their previous year, Big Ben produced the best statistical year of his career to date, gathering 13.2 rebounds, 1.3 steals, and 2.3 blocks a game. Remember, this was at a time when pace was at its slowest in history, with the 2000-2001 season being the fourth slowest ever at the time and remaining the ninth slowest of all time to this date. Wallace on the season finished second in rebounds and 10th in blocks per game. It sat next to Tim Duncan, Shaquille O'Neal, and Dikembe Mutombo as the only players to finish in the top 10 for blocked shots while averaging double-digit rebounds. He was also just one of three players to average at least one steal and two blocks a game, along with David Robinson and Marcus Camby. The following season would begin his run as arguably the best defensive player in the NBA for half a decade and easily the most decorated defensive peak in league history. From 2001-02 to 2005-06, Wallace would be named to the All-Defensive First Team in all five seasons, win four Defensive Player of the Year awards, make four All-Star teams, and finish runner-up in Defensive Player of the Year voting in the only time he did not win the award. That was the least of Wallace's issues that season, as he finished seventh in MVP voting, which remains the highest MVP finish for a player not to average double-digit scoring, besides Bill Russell in 1969 when he finished fifth, and Wes Unseld in 1975 when he finished ninth. Oh, and he led Detroit to an NBA championship with a 4-1 win against the Lakers, containing Shaquille O'Neal, Kobe Bryant, Karl Malone, and Gary Payton. Statistically, during this time period, Big Ben led the league in blocks once, rebounds twice, averaged three blocks a game three straight seasons, and over 1.6 steals a game for four straight seasons. On top of that, he finished sixth in total steals in this time period, and the only center that was inside the top 10, finished second in total rebounds only to Kevin Garnett, and was the only player to record at least 1,000 blocks. Add to that, he was just one of two players to average at least 1.5 steals and 2.5 blocks a game, along with Andrei Kirilenko, and you have a guy that did everything on one side of the ball for his team. For my money, there is no doubt that Big Ben was the best player for the Pistons during this time period, and had he dominated in this fashion on the offensive end, he would have been regarded as the best player in the game. Along with the dominance of his play on the defensive end of the floor, Detroit as a team began to shape and develop. The Pistons returned to the playoffs in 2001-02 with a 50-32 record as they moved into the second round, before another 50-32 record in 2002-03 saw them take some major steps towards the ultimate goal. Making the conference finals, the team would acquire three of its core five for the championship team. In the draft of 2002, Tayshaun Prince joined the team with the 23rd pick, Chauncey Billups would sign with the squad via free agency, and Rip Hamilton would make his way to the Motor City in a trade with Hubert Davis and Bobby Simmons of Bryan Cardinal and Jerry Stackhouse. The Detroit Pistons of 2003-04 are often regarded as one of the best single-season champions of all time. The big reason was the acquirement of Rasheed Wallace mid-season, but in large part this is thanks to the anchoring of their defensive unit by Ben Wallace. With Wallace leading the team, Detroit sucked the life out of their opposition. The Pistons held their opponents to the lowest points per game average and three-point shooting percentage across the league, a top three for opposing team free throws made and attempted, field goals made and field goal percentage. They also finished top five in opposing three-point makes, two-point makes and two-point percentage, defensive rebounds, total rebounds and total assists. They were suffocating, and Wallace was the leader of it all. In the regular season and postseason combined, they only allowed their opponents to score 100 points five times and still managed to win three of those five games. They held teams under 60 points once, under 70 points 17 times, and under 80 points 35 times. Wallace does not get enough credit for the player that he was after their championship success, thanks to the Malice in the Palace on November 19th, 2004. There are enough documentaries and details about this event already, but suffice to say that it was a black mark on the resume of everyone involved for over 15 years after the incident. So overshadowing was the impact that many forget the tremendous run Detroit had following the event, where they made another NBA Finals and two separate conference finals, and the play of Wallace himself, who won two more Defensive Player of the Year awards. There is no doubt it was this moment in time that looked to have Wallace blackballed from the Naismith Hall of Fame. That was until he was enshrined in 2021. Wallace's career may have petered out after his Detroit years, but his contributions have never been forgotten.